I'd like to thank Dr. Bateman and the other organizers for this meeting itself, and specifically for inviting me here. And it's pretty clear to me that I understand my role based upon the content of the lectures of the rest of the presenters. And my role here is to lower the bar. So this is going to be pretty basic, pretty low. The other thing is, Cindy called me the other day, having looked at my presentation. I guess I had the decimal in the wrong place. I thought I had 300 minutes, and she said that I've only got 30 minutes. I was still confused, so I set it down to 3 minutes. So I'm going to be through in record time here for you guys. I won't repeat the first compliment, because that was sort of just wasting time, but this quote is from Alan Rechhaven, and probably nobody or very few people in this room know who Alan Rechhaven is, but Rechhaven and Kale are the two physicians that developed the scoring system that we use or have used for the last 30 years for staging sleep as stage 1, 2, 3, 4, and so forth. And so it is a particularly relevant quote by Alan that if sleep doesn't have a particularly vital function, it's one very large mistake. I'll begin also with asking this question, which is, what do you think are the most frequently reported sleep problems in the United States? And this is from the National Sleep Foundation survey in 1991. As you can see, fatigue is the most common symptom that was reported. Now, this doesn't specify, you know, what the particular sleep disorder is, but for example, when I go to a function and somebody asks me what I do, and I usually reluctantly say that I'm a physician, and then they say, what kind of a physician are you? And I say, I'm a pulmonologist, because then they won't ask me another question. But because no one wants to know about emphysema, but if I say I'm a sleep doctor, then the next thing they say is, you know, I had this dream, or I can't sleep, or, you know, whatever it is. But insomnia is kind of the thing that's in most people's mind, is, you know, what a sleep doctor takes care of. It turns out that fatigue is probably the most common symptom that we deal with all the time. I was at a meeting where William Dement, who was one of the individuals who described rapid eye movement sleep and the association with dreaming, and he asked the audience of sleep specialists this question: what is the one symptom that you have when you're sleepy? And we all have a little different take on what it is when we personally feel sleepy, but one of the important things to remember is that there's often a big disconnect between whether the brain is sleepy and needing sleep and whether you perceive sleep to be sleepiness to be present. We all feel it in a little bit different way, and these are some of the symptoms that were put out by various individuals. And mood changes and irritability is a very, very, very common symptom. And if you sleep deprive people, it's one of the most outstanding symptoms, obviously followed by fatigue, lack of energy, and as you can see there. The heavy eyes is also a very common symptom and has been utilized to, for example, in the car manufacturer, Volvo has developed a technique for looking at the eyes. And if you start to see the eyes closing, it's an indication that the driver is sleepy. And I guess it shuts down the car or something, but but the eyes, it's very interesting why the eyes are so relevant to the problem of sleepiness. But the last comment is unintentional sleep episodes. I get a lot of my material from the Salt Lake Tribune, and this was published in March 31st, 2006. You can read the main headline that the trucker was guilty in the crash deaths. These are excerpts taken from that newspaper article. They were in three cars among 100s last June that slowed for an accident. William Camp Price, 80, of Salt Lake City, was apparently on his way home from a day of golf. Misty Braille, year 35, of Bountiful, was teaching her newly licensed 16-year-old daughter how to drive on a freeway. Rachel McTeer of American Fork was returning from visiting a Nevada cousin stricken with cancer. But one driver failed to slow, Robbie Joseph Dalrymple, driving a semi-trailer truck, plowed into the stalled cars, killing McTeer, Price, and Braillier, and leaving Braillier's daughter, Courtney, paralyzed from the neck down. Dalrymple had an unobstructed view of the highway ahead, as well as a clear view of the stalled traffic, which was backed up for miles because of a head-on crash at 7200 West, where an alleged drunken driver had already killed two people. The judge also noted that Dalrymple, who claimed he was driving 65 miles per hour, never hit his brakes, according to witnesses, in an absence of skid marks. McTeer's father, mother, and sister hugged Dalrymple following the verdict, and tears flowed as he apologized. "I am sorry. I am so sorry." Dalrymple was not under the influence of drugs or alcohol, and despite a couple of irregularities, his logbooks show he had not been driving longer than permitted by federal regulations. McTeer's family believes he was trying to stay awake before the crash because of the many cigarette butts and cans of Mountain Dew found in the cab of his truck. Utah Highway Patrol Trooper Beveridge asked Dalrymple what had happened, and the trucker answered, "I honestly don't know. That's what scares me the most. I don't remember a thing. I don't know where my head was at." Dalrymple also said that the last landmark he recalled seeing was 10 miles back, the Flying J truck stop at the Tooele exit. So what has happened here is this is an example of automatic behavior. You know, where you go from here to downtown and you don't remember going there, that's automatic behavior. You're not processing that information. Dalrymple drove competently during those 10 miles, testified truck driver Jerry Workman, who was driving behind Dalrymple's truck until the crash occurred. "Yes, I was surprised he didn't stop," testified Workman. "He should have been able to see the stalled traffic better than me." So what problem caused Dalrymple to kill three people and paralyze another one? Sleep. And one of the properties of sleep is something referred to as perceptual disengagement. So what that means is that the moment that you fall asleep, your brain, or at least your perception of information, changes. You stop hearing, you stop seeing, you stop processing information. It's when the fellow is in church and he starts to snore and he is given the elbow by his wife and he says, "I was awake, I wasn't asleep," but he was snoring. So why would he not know that? It's because of perceptual disengagement. The moment that you fall asleep, you stop processing this information. It's blocked at the level of the thalamus. You know when you wake up. You never know the second that you fall asleep. You only know when you wake up. And so the brain continues to work. It's continuing to think. That's what the brain does. It's a thinking organ. But it stops processing this information and processes information within the brain itself. This is an example of a 30-second epoch of data. On the top two lines are eye movements. The third line is EMG, muscle tone. Then you have two EEG patterns, and the bottom is the electrocardiogram. Right through here, you see rolling eye movements, and that's the signature of stage one sleep, very light sleep. Here you see an alpha rhythm, which is an indication of the brain being awake. Here the brain is slowing down, and you see that the waves are slower and clearly stage one sleep. And then you see that the brain is awake at that point. So this is an example of a micro sleep within 30 seconds. Now, you would never, ever know that you were asleep, but here's 15, 16, 17 seconds of sleep embedded in wakefulness. So how far do you go in that period of time at 65 or 75 miles an hour? And when you are asleep, there is perceptual disengagement. So during that 16 seconds, you're not processing what you're doing. And that's a question of attentiveness.
And if you're not attentive, you can't process information, you can't learn information. So people who complain of memory may have attention problems due to this sort of a process. Now, unfortunately, I can't show you this video because the computer won't show it. You may have seen this in the past. It was on the internet drive cam, and it just shows 10 seconds of this fellow with his eyes closed. You can see that here on the video. He's actually driving the car, and for 10 seconds he drives the car, and then he crashes and he rolls, and he ends up with his head outside the window. And I wish I could show it to you, but you get the idea, and you can see that this fellow is asleep driving. So the point of all this is that fatigue is the most common symptom of a sleep disorder, and it may be a extremely important symptom, not just from the point of view of being inconvenienced and not feeling well, but putting you and others at risk. So when I tell people finally that I am a sleep doctor, they say, well, how much sleep do I need and what kind of sleep and so forth? So what do you need to get rid of fatigue? First, you need to sleep enough, on average 7 to 9 hours, depending upon age. Sleep, if we look at it from the point of view of this being a two-process model, there's a homeostatic need and there's a circadian pacemaker issue. It's like, how much water do you need? To maintain homeostasis, you have to sleep a certain amount. And so the first issue is making sure that you're not getting only 5 or 6 hours of sleep, which is terribly insufficient. The second issue is synchronization with the circadian pacemaker. Within the hypothalamus is a pacemaker. It tells you, you know, when you should be going to sleep and when you get up. I just got back from Italy, so my pacemaker is somewhere still over the Atlantic Ocean. But, you know, when you go someplace, it takes a period of time to adjust. And that's due to the hypothalamus and the pacemaker. And there's many other biologic rhythms that are driven accordingly. Temperature cycle, cortisol, many, many other rhythms are synchronized. And so sleep, to be optimal, should occur at the time that it's supposed to, not in the middle of the day when you're working at night. That's not the normal time for sleep. This seems pretty silly, but you need to have an intact central nervous system. And by that I mean not just the neurons and the structure needs to be there, but you also don't want the brain poisoned by medications, for example. And so I'm referring to a central nervous system that's been uncorrupted and has all the necessary neurons to generate sleep. And the last element, which is really important, is the continuity of sleep. People are always focused and obsessed about, oh, I didn't get slow wave sleep, or how much REM sleep did I get on this test? And, you know, so we're going over all the test results, and people focus on those sorts of issues. But even more important is whether or not that sleep is fragmented or solid. In order to sleep properly, you need the right amount. It has to be at the right time. You have to have the right brain, and you should not have interruptions of your sleep. This shows you a sleep histogram of a young female, and I'll try to talk and do this. Maybe if I come up there at work. This shows that she is awake at this point. She falls to stage one sleep. This is slow wave sleep here. This is the first REM period. This is the first sleep cycle, the second, and so forth. And so as the night continues, the amount of REM sleep increases. The slow wave sleep is predominantly in the first part of the night. And here you see a few awakenings across the night, which is not unusual for being in a sleep laboratory. This is the sleep histogram of a very old female. And amazingly, she still has REM sleep. But you can see, obviously, that her sleep profile is extremely fragmented by many, many awakenings across the night. So here's a patient that came to me, typical of many of our patients, 55-year-old female, tired all the time. I'm always tired. When I go to sleep at night, it seems to me I've had enough sleep. I wake up tired. It's sometimes hard to fall asleep. I've had this problem for 4 years, maybe more. Because of my constant pain, I wear down easily. I have pain in my lower back, both legs, shoulders, arms, hands, neck, lower back. And so we see this fairly often. Here's the algorithm that I use. We'll assume that you've worked the patient up, doesn't have cancer, doesn't have hypothyroidism, doesn't have any other identifiable condition that would readily explain the problem of fatigue. My experience is that given that scenario, they have a sleep disorder until proven otherwise. Now, I don't know anything about chronic fatigue syndrome. I see patients who have chronic fatigue, and so I can't comment on that specific entity, but that's for the other experts present. But from an operational point of view, when I'm seeing a patient and they complain of fatigue and they've already done everything else, then the cause of their fatigue is most likely poor sleep. So if you're sleeping and your sleep is not good, it's probably because of arousals that are occurring. So why would you be having arousals? What would be the mechanism? Well, one thing I just mentioned is you've got to have an intact brain. So you have to have a good central nervous system. If you have Alzheimer's disease, you have a degeneration of neurons, and as the Alzheimer's problem gets worse, so does the sleep problem. They correlate with each other. If you have a mood problem, we all know if you're going to be doing something the next day and you're anxious or you don't feel good emotionally, you're not tranquil, you're not going to sleep very good. So the first thing that I'm looking at is whether there are any issues regarding the central nervous system or a mood disorder. Going back to our patient, 55-year-old female, tired all the time. She gives me these other complaints: frequent morning headaches, sleep is never restorative, tired, fatigued, poor concentration, constantly irritated, considered suicide, libido none, no cataplexy. She said, "I never laugh." Well, she has obviously some significant problems, probably with depression. The second component is respiration. You know, if you're asleep and your oxygen isn't what it ought to be, and maybe you've got some secretions, maybe you've got a bronchitis, and you have to cough that up to breathe, you want the smoke detector to go off in order to alert the brain to fix the problem. And that's exactly what happens. The smoke detectors actually are the carotid bodies that relay the information to the brain, and the brain wakes up and takes care of the problem. So any kind of respiratory problem, any respiratory problem, whatever it is, not just obstructive sleep apnea, any respiratory problem going on during the night is like a stimulus to breathe. And often we'll have people complaining of sleep onset insomnia, and you look at their record and you actually see that as soon as they fall asleep, they stop breathing. And therefore it wakes them up, and they never, ever, ever know that there was any breathing problem whatsoever. But they feel insomnia. So breathing problems during the night, there are various mechanisms by which that is mediated to the brain. One of those is carbon dioxide level, and there are others which we won't try to get into today. Now, those are the two most important reasons why the arousal center of the brain is going to be activated. When you're asleep, the brain doesn't really care a lot about what's going on in the adrenal gland or in the thyroid gland or almost anywhere else. Now, this is obviously a very great oversimplification, because if you have pain, for example, that is going to be a factor, and that has to be taken into consideration. But again, I just point out that this is just a way that I have of operationally looking at patients when they come in. And so I look at their mood status, their neurologic status, and then I'm looking at them to see, how do I know they don't have a breathing problem during sleep? We suffer because about 350 million years ago, this lungfish evolved and had some problems coming out of the ocean, which was, how do you get oxygen in and carbon dioxide out, and how do you keep yourself from drying out and so forth. And these animals got air into their system by swallowing it. We developed a mechanism in which we aspirate air. We suck the air in. We generate a suction pressure, and that leads to this problem, which is that the upper airway tends to collapse during sleep because we are sucking the air in. And if you happen to be on your back or you have other risk factors, you get a narrowing of the upper airway, as shown in this diagram. This is an example of obstructive sleep apnea. It shows periods of no airflow here with breathing effort and changes of oxygen saturation. So this is an example of a person who has an obstructive apnea, and the question is, how come you don't die every time? If you were in a restaurant and you got something in your throat, you would hope that, you know, someone would give you a Heimlich maneuver or something. Why do you not die during the middle of the night? It's because of this. These are micro awakenings. This is the EEG on the top. Eye movements are in red. Leg jerks are the blue below. And what happens is the brain figures out that there's a problem and there's an arousal. And this is fragmenting the sleep. So this is the problem. It's not that there's not enough stage whatever. The problem is that all the time that the person's asleep, there are arousals occurring over and over and over and over again. And this process leads to a whole constellation of problems besides fatigue. There are metabolic consequences, insulin resistance, and many other problems. So this is the problem of obstructive breathing or respiratory problems at night, is that it fragments the sleep. So how do patients with sleep apnea present? Well, often they're brought in by their loving spouse, and the person themselves has no idea that there is a problem. And so what are the risk factors? The first one is some information about disturbed sleep. It can be anything. Insomnia, nocturia, agitation. In kids, for example, they'll get in weird sleeping positions. They'll be restless. When you sleep, you're not doing anything. You're just quiet. And if you're not quiet and just laying there, then there's a problem. Abnormal breathing problem. So some indication that the upper airway is not right. Snoring, snorting, pauses. Testosterone. Obviously, this is more common in men, postmenopausal females, and in females who have polycystic ovary disease. Obesity, reflected either by the body mass index or the neck circumference. Craniofacial features, large tonsils, large tongue, small mandible. Cardiovascular diseases, hypertension, heart failure. Neurovascular diseases. 70% of people admitted to the LDS hospital, any hospital, admitted to the hospital with a stroke or a TIA have sleep apnea. 70% of people with TIAs and strokes have sleep apnea. 50% of people with heart failure with an ejection fraction of 0.4 or less have sleep apnea. About 70-80% of people who have hypertension have sleep disordered breathing. Medications. What medications can cause sleep apnea? We'll show you in a minute. So we'll get back to the patient, 55-year-old female, tired all the time. How much sleep do you get? She gets 8 hours. What's her sleep quality like? She complains of insomnia, fragmented sleep. It's not clear whether she snores or has apnea. She's divorced. She weighs 280 pounds. She has a body mass index of 48. This is a woman of size. She has had this past medical history, those medications. This is her sleep histogram, and this is quite interesting. It shows that she is awake here. She is asleep and has a very long period of REM sleep, which is unusual. It normally is short. I showed you what a normal young female looks like, and this is the signature of somebody who has depression, of a major mood disorder. Long, long initial REM period, short REM latency, so that the sleep information gives us some additional data besides just the sleep apnea. And on the bottom line, you see the oximetry. She actually did have some sleep apnea, about 14 an hour. So the diagnosis in this lady, sleep apnea, at least mild, it may be worse than what we look at. Clinical importance, I think it's important in her. Depression, for sure. She has restless leg syndrome, and she has chronic pain. So this is why it's tough. It's tough to take care of these folks because they have so many issues. Recommendations, she ought to be tested with CPAP. She needs iron studies for restless legs and Mirapex or Requip. She obviously needs some attention for her antidepressants. And then the question comes up, okay, given this person who has a high probability of sleep apnea, can you use a sleeping pill? She's got pain. What do opioids do? How about Provigil? She's tired. Can you use these medications in people who have undiagnosed, unrecognized sleep apnea, which happens all the time? How much time do I have? 3 hours? The bottom line on hypnotics is that they are amazingly very safe. but some individuals will have worsening of their sleep apnea. So most of the data shows that there are rather minimal effects of benzos on apnea duration, oxygenation. Otherwise, we'd be having people arriving in the emergency room all the time from the complications. We published an article moving on to opioids in 2003 in which we recognized some problems. We also published or have published or are publishing this article which extends that, in which we looked at 60 people on narcotics versus 60 people who were controls. And this shows you one of the cases. Actually, I'm just going to get down to the bottom of this. This is a 43-year-old female who was not obese, had hypertension, she had pain, maybe some witnessed apneas, she was on methadone, fentanyl. This is her sleep pattern, and you can see on the bottom her oximetry tracing showing severe hypoxemia. At the end, she's on some oxygen. This shows her breathing pattern, which is highly irregular and which we recognize as ataxic breathing. It does not go away with oxygen, and this is referred to also as Bio's respiration, who described this in 1876 in a fellow with meningitis, and basically it's just a very chaotic, irregular breathing pattern. The significance of that is unclear, but a number of articles have shown that this ataxic, irregular breathing pattern presages the development of respiratory arrest. This is in children. There's other articles in adults showing that before the individual develops respiratory arrest, respiratory failure, the breathing pattern becomes irregular. You don't stop breathing, you just get irregular breathing. The other interesting thing is that when you have these people who have sleep apnea and you put them on CPAP, they invariably get worse. So it becomes a real problem. This is a patient who had been on effective CPAP and in the interim was placed on narcotics and came in with complaints of fatigue. And this is a sleep study beginning on her what was previously effective CPAP at that level of 15 centimeters, which was then increased to 10 centimeters increased to 15 centimeters of water pressure. And what is interesting is that she has central apneas in non-REM sleep. She has normal irregular breathing in REM sleep. And this is typically what happens. The person comes in with bad sleep disordered breathing. They're on opioids and they have horrible oxygenation. And you try to push the CPAP and they get worse and they get worse. This article appeared April 2001. That's Timothy McVeigh, who did the bombing in Oklahoma City. Kind of an interesting. You might have seen this study published in Morbidity and Mortality, looking at why do people die. This shows from the year 1991 to 2003 the number of deaths that were due to non-illicit drugs. That's the blue line. Going up dramatically. So those are deaths due to medications which were prescribed, correlated with this information. You can get this on methadone, oxycodone, hydrocodone. Basically, it shows that the prescription rate of these medications increased dramatically, corresponding with that period of time. This shows when they broke down the time frame between 1991 and 1998 and compared that with 1999 to 2003, where there seemed to be a big increase in the death rate, that the cumulative death rate increased by 200%. This was especially true in females, 261%. The percent change in death rate due to methadone was 1,000%, 1,600% increase in death rate due to oxycodone. This occurred in people, the 208% change in death rate was in those people who were not obese. So, females, methadone, oxycodone, non-obese. We also looked at this data to see if we could identify any indication that these people were dying due to respiratory disturbances, and without being able to show you a lot of what we have done, this information was presented at the European Respiratory Society meeting. There's the actual time of death in red, which seemed to be about the same across the day versus estimated time of death, especially in the morning. So these people basically wake up dead. And our conclusions were that the timing, the circumstances, the location of death suggested that these occurred during sleep, no big surprise, and that the association of ataxic breathing induced by opioids and respiratory depression documented in other studies suggests that these deaths may have been caused by sleep disordered breathing. This was in the Salt Lake Tribune, Wednesday, April the 4th, so this is current information. Methadone killed so I hope that doesn't happen to me. So the conclusions, chronic fatigue is the most common symptom of insufficient sleep, and it is potentially fatal, not only to the person that has the problem, but to the rest of us. Unexplained fatigue is most likely secondary to an underlying or unrecognized sleep disorder. Sleep-disordered breathing is extremely common and must be excluded in any patient with chronic unexplained fatigue. And therapy with some medications, in particular opioids, increases the risk for potentially fatal respiratory events during sleep. And with that, I'll quit.